I just added this subtitle of athletic pubalgia to my groin pain talk because that's what I really want to focus in on here. When we look at pelvic pain in general, need to think about different etiologies, and that could be, you know, a lot of things that could be visceral sources of pain, whether it's gynecologic, urologic, GI. We're not going to cover that. Orthopedic problems, we'll get into that. Or you could have neurological problems as well. And on Thursday, I have some material on nerve imaging that's somewhat new that might be pertinent to this area. But in the orthopedic and visceral world, kind of this idea of hernia or a sports hernia is out there, and I want to explain that a little bit and hopefully help you understand it. An important take-home point is that if you just think about groin pain in general, then by and large, the vast majority of those patients have some problem with the hip. So that's, you know, 90% of it, and then there's lesser numbers of people that have an actual hernia, and then or this what we're going to call sports or sportsman's hernia. But a number of different things can affect the hip joint, whether it's arthritis, AVN, stress injury, all the tendinous and soft tissue things. So again, that's usually the first thing to think about. What about this idea about sports hernia? Well, it seemed to come around in the 1980s where I think perhaps particularly in Great Britain and perhaps in Australia or other, you know, sporting countries, that the idea was that patients can have a disorder of the inguinal region called like an incipient hernia or a potential hernia, like a traditional bowel hernia. But then around the 90s, then it became recognized that there are a number of tendinous and muscular things around the pubic symphysis that can be symptomatic, and that kind of got lumped under this concept of sports hernia as well, even though they have really nothing to do with the hernia. And then that's recognized as a kind of a bad term, so now people start talking about athletic pubalgia or just pain, you know, in the pubic area in athletes. So that's still not a great term, but we'll talk about that quite a bit. So that's basically groin pain in a person that can't be attributed to hip joint pain or hip tendon pathology. Excuse me, it tends to lateralize to one side. It's often a chronic condition rather than an acute thing. And it's bony, myotendinous, and abdominal wall disorders kind of lumped into one kind of overall arching clinical syndrome, if you will. It's probably the best terminology to use these days is so-called core muscle injury, CMI, core muscle injury, and we'll get into why that is. Much more common in males than females, and has to do with participation in sports that involve a lot of changes in direction, twisting, kicking, especially things like soccer, Australian rules football, maybe American football, things like that, hockey. So let's look at some of the anatomy, and we're going to talk about bones, tendons, and muscles, and a little bit about abdominal wall, more traditionally towards the end. So we have the pubic symphysis here. We'll talk about that in a moment in more detail. Remember the inguinal ligament and the abdominal wall musculature form in the, you know, different layers of the abdominal wall, superficial inguinal ring and the old conjoint tendon that comes in medially. That's important anatomy, but what we're going to talk about more is this rectus abdominis and the adductors and their relationship to the pubic symphysis. So the symphysis is the bony joint in the midline of our pelvis, and it's a fibrocartilaginous joint here on a coronal section from a cadaver. So there's kind of a corrugated anatomy to it with the cartilage insinuating within the bone, in especially seen in younger patients. It turns out as we get older, it's very common for a cleft to develop within the symphysis. So in this old anatomy drawing here, you have an actual fluid-filled cleft. That's not necessarily abnormal. There are ligaments that surround the pubic symphysis. It's quite a stable joint normally, but there is a lot of degenerative change that can occur and stress change about the symphysis, and we'll look at that. So here's another cadaver specimen pubic symphysis, the superior and inferior ligaments here. Here's a sagittal view of the symphysis, just reminding us that it's an ovoid structure in cross-section. So let's start to talk about the muscles. So you have the rectus abdominis muscle coming down here, and it is in continuity with this tendinous tissue over the anterior aspect of the symphysis, leading to the adductor longus muscle. That's the main kind of continuity of things. So it brings up this idea of this rectus abdominis adductor longus aponeurosis. And it turns out that this area we can call the pubic plate in front of the symphysis here. We can also talk about specific tendons, but pubic plate is one that we'll talk about. So on this cadaver diagram here, here's the rectus abdominis. Here's a little bit of pyramidalis muscle, which is not that important, but rectus coming down in almost continuity directly with the adductor longus, and then inferior and medial to that, the short adductors like gracilis and so on in here. So rectus adductor longus. Here's another example of that. I just show a few different variations on that so you can kind of drill it home. So here's a dissection going on. The examiner's like lifting up fingers underneath the rectus, rectus abdominis, and the tendons coming down here, and here's the bone in the background, the red, but then it's basically in this aponeurotic continuity with adductor longus here. If I take away the bone, it's just continuous soft tissue, actually probably much more complexity than we see. There's all kind of crossings and so on. But this is this core muscle group that reinforces abdominal wall into the groin region. And another example here. So how do we image this? Well, we have a dedicated pubalgia protocol, and you know, if anybody's interested in the details of our protocols, we're happy to share them. They're not really online because of the format they're in, but we can make them available. They're not really that magnificent or fantastic, but they're tailored to what we want to achieve. For this protocol, we do overview images of the whole pelvis, so T1 and T2 fat suppression to look at, you know, general anatomy, hips and so forth, although it's not a dedicated, you know, hip protocol, axial T2 fat suppression. And then we drill down and we get small field of view around the pubic symphysis. And this includes axial T1 and fat suppressed T2 weighted images at field of view about 20, so pretty small, about half what we would do for a normal pelvis, sagittal images, and then we do oblique proton density and T2 fat suppressed images to the symphysis. That's what I call axial oblique. We'll look at the coronal oblique, which is an option as well. So we're targeting into the pubic symphysis. So here's that small field of view, axial T1 and the T2 fat suppressed images, just to give you a flavor for the field of view. We'll go over the anatomy in a second. Sagittal T1 and T2 fat suppressed images. So the T1s are really nice to see the muscle boundaries surrounding fat. Here you see that ovoid symphysis. And the T2s are obviously sensitive for fluid. We'll look at that again in a moment. The oblique axial that we like to do, it's based on, you know, a lot of the nice work from this came out of Adam Zoga and colleagues at Thomas Jefferson in Philadelphia. And they have a lot of experience with this because of something, a surgeon that I'll mention in a moment. But this perpendicular oblique plane to the symphysis kind of is perpendicular to that rectus adductor aponeurosis, so it's a really nice plane to look at the anatomy. And so it lays out pubic symphysis and then the tendons that come off of it, and you're basically in cross-section. So, you know, this little icon, it shows a little bit of edema in the symphysis, maybe a little cyst, but this is just to show you the orientation of that scan plane. The opposite would be what I think of as coronal oblique, and that's sort of longitudinal to the symphysis. It looks like that cadaver specimen or diagram that I showed. You know, it's a nice plane. I'm not sure it's really as useful as the other plane because you're like parallel to that rectus adductor aponeurosis. So Bill Myers, who is a surgeon in Philadelphia, he was at Jefferson. I think he's more or less on his own now, and he's close to retirement, but he, when I was at Duke in the early 90s, I guess, he was a general surgeon, but then he started to pick up this idea of treating these sports hernias and doing all the surgeries around the groin area and symphysis, and then moved to Philadelphia to kind of proliferate that. And I think he's one of the ones that's responsible for this term, kind of core muscle injury. And so here's a number of the different variants that he lists on the website from their institute. So all these different variants that, again, you don't need to know any of this. It's just the idea is there's a number of different probably syndromes and combinations of things that can get injured that this institute, the Vincera Institute, Dr. Myers has says, there's 121 different combinations of core muscle injuries, and by the way, there's a corresponding number of surgeries to repair them. And so they do a lot of surgery in his institute there, and it's not always entirely clear, you know, what operation they're doing. I mean, they're doing surgery on these different areas to like debride, repair, and fix these things. That has a reasonably good success rate, but I can't tell you, oh, it's 80% or any particular number. This looks like an Italian restaurant menu to me. I sort of prefer the pepperoni and mushroom myself. So let's talk about some injury patterns. And so what about the bones? So that's kind of our foundation. So we have the pubic symphysis, and you want to look at the bony contours. Are there osteophytes? Is there edema in the bone marrow? So here's some reactive edema in the left side of the pubic symphysis here. And so that can be reactive edema, kind of stress change. You know, it could be inflammatory or infectious in a certain situation, but typically this is just reactive edema. So that can be termed under the terminology of osteitis pubis. When we look at tendons, again, just remember I mentioned the rectus abdominis going into the adductor longus. So the pubic plate here in front of the pubic symphysis on this coronal pubic plate here, rectus abdominis, and then the adductor longus tendons coming off, okay? And then the short adductors kind of hidden behind here inferiorly, that can also get injured. So as we look at imaging, we'll specify some of those things and just give you an idea of what we can see on imaging and how we might describe them on a report. So again, I'll show like a sagittal reference image. The green line is obviously the image that corresponds to the plane on the right. And so here is an oblique axial image showing fluid signal deep to the pubic plate. It's a little bit elevated up off of the bone. It should be firmly applied to the bone. So that could be considered a pubic plate disruption or partial avulsion, I suppose. if we look at that on a scrolling view here, can't quite see my controller there, but here's the region of that pubic plate. And if you look at these dark structures here and here, that's the adductor longus tendon as we get into the actual, go below the symphysis into the groin. So again, here and here, adductor longus. And I'll try to point with this other thing as well. But the bones look fairly normal. The tendons themselves look fairly normal in this particular case so far. Here's the straight up axial images. And so here's the region of that pubic plate right in there. And you can see that fluid that's undercutting it right about there. But the adductor longus tendons on the straight axial, again, look, these dark round circles right there and there, that's longus, and those are normal looking tendons. So we have the oblique axial, we have the straight up axial, and we have sagittal. And the anatomy I want to point out on the sagittals is really kind of if we come to the midline here, this is this nice anatomy where you have the rectus abdominis, it's forming into tendon, the pubic plate in front, and then it's going to basically blend into the adductor longus. So if we go just a little bit off midline, here's adductor longus here, and the same on T2. And notice that there shouldn't be any high signal at the origin of the adductor longus right in here. Now in the midline in this patient, you do see this focal area of limited disruption of the pubic plate itself, but the adductor tendons look normal. So I like these sagittal images quite a lot to look at especially the origin of the adductor longus. Okay, so let's start to look at some pathology here. And we think about the bones, we want to think about the tendons, and then what different tendon components are abnormal. And I'm going to admit right up front here, it's a complicated, there's a lot of terminology going on here. So the idea is to identify the injuries, do the best you can to describe what you think they are. Now, a number of these cases I've sent to Philadelphia with my report, and I said, would you have called this the same way? And they're like, yeah, pretty much, which is a nice way of saying, maybe. But so I've tried to be more specific over time. So here's one I would call pubic plate and adductor longus injury. So here's coronal images. Here's the pubic symphysis here. Look at the left side. So this is adductor longus on the right. On the T2 weighted image, here's adductor longus coming off, and there's this area of focal increased signal. That can be tendinopathy, that can be an area of partial tearing, okay? Here's the axial images. So there is some degenerative change in the pubic symphysis. There's some cysts forming here. There's like intermediate signal in the pubic plate here, especially on the left side. And then you have to decide, is that really involving the adductor longus, or is it just right next to it? Or is it some combination of both things? And it could be combinations of both things. So this can be pubic plate degeneration, partial avulsion or tearing, possibly partial adductor longus tearing, but in general, the majority of the adductor longus is okay in this case. Here in this format, we'll scroll through because hopefully this helps you see things a little bit better. So here we are, more superior, starting to get into the symphysis, and it's hard for me to see the screen here, but like right in here. So there's this area of increased signal in the region of the proximal adductor longus pubic plate. Now as we go further inferiorly, what you're gonna notice is another thing. We'll get into this in a second more, but see this cleft of high signal there more inferiorly on the pubic symphysis. That's where the short adductors come off. So higher up here on the right side, which is relatively normal, this is the normal adductor longus. The left side is the abnormal adductor longus, or right next to it. And then on the right, it's this extra cleft. Okay, so it's this curvilinear signal right there. And so that's the so-called secondary cleft sign, which we'll talk about more in just a second. Again, recapping on this patient. So here's the coronal. You can have a cleft in the midline of the symphysis. You have that focal partial tearing here, the pubic plate, adductor longus. But further inferiorly and posteriorly, see on the reference here, so here's the symphysis. So the adductor longus comes off more proximally and anteriorly right here. And the short adductors come off more inferiorly, the lower aspect of the symphysis. And then on the right side, you have this secondary cleft here. So it's a primary cleft and a so-called secondary cleft where there's partial tearing of the adductor, the short adductor tendons, okay? A little bit of alphabet soup here. But so here's a different patient, incidentally picked up. He had a little bit of a hip pointer thing up here and here, and there is a little bit of fluid in the symphysis. There's a secondary cleft right here. And this brings up the idea, you know, if you see this incidentally, should we say that this patient has a quote, sports hernia? My answer is absolutely not. First of all, we don't use the term sports hernia in our dictations because it's really a misnomer. We could say that there's fluid in a cleft, you know, and there could be a secondary cleft sign in the pubic symphysis, or there. I might even in the right athletic population just say there are degenerative changes about the symphysis because I don't really want to bring up something that could well be asymptomatic in a patient who, you know, may have implications for their draft status or whatever, especially if it's for another injury. We can talk more about that as we move along or in the question and answer, how to handle the sort of semantics of discussing these things in a report. So here's that same patient. So if we look at the axials, the left side's fairly normal here. The right side has this cleft. And as we go scrolling through, you know, you can see that cleft pretty well here, okay, off the lower aspect of the symphysis. So I haven't done a lot of these, but we've done in the past some pubic symphysis injections. And in the normal person, you can have a primary cleft where it's just a little fluid-filled space between the cartilage layers of the symphysis. What I didn't realize, this is an old image, this is probably from 15 years ago, was that in some patients with this injury, you can actually see fluid tracking along this sort of secondary cleft. And that is a sign of injury to the adductors, the short adductors, it turns out. The long adductor comes off more superiorly, so that's gonna create a cleft up in here that we'll look at in a second. Okay, so several nice articles, and I have references at the very end here that should be in your PDF as well, but remember, rectus abdominis coming down to the adductor longus, that whole pubic plate. Here's the pubic symphysis. So normally, you know, in young people, we don't have a cleft there. But a lot of us, you know, we'll get a cleft that's normal, just like maybe minimal motion at that site, that's normal. But this secondary cleft is where these short adductors start to tear off and you get fluid that can track in there, okay? So the secondary cleft is related to tears of the short adductors, adductor brevis, the gracilis, some articles say pectineus, some don't. And then there's a different cleft called the superior cleft, and this has been described relatively more recently, maybe in the last 5 years or so, and it's a marker of tear of the actual adductor longus, or the rectus adductor aponeurosis, kind of that whole situation there. So here's an example here of injecting the symphyseal cleft, the superior cleft sign, that's where the adductor longus comes off, and the old secondary cleft sign here. So same kind of deal here. So here's rectus, here's a superior cleft where the adductor longus is next to rectus. Here's that secondary cleft in blue here. Okay, so those are, you know, the terminology may not be that critical. Probably the one you want to be aware of mostly is that secondary cleft sign. So here's a patient who has, you know, several different things going on, and we're going to describe them as we go. So he's an ultra runner. He's got some degenerative change of the symphysis, maybe a little bit of mild bone marrow edema on the left. There's a cyst forming here. The pubic plate's not quite normal. It's a little bit elevated, probably some tendinopathy and so on involving the central part of the plate here. as we go a little bit further inferiorly, we start to see elevation of the adductor longus here on the right side. Okay, so that's where the longus is coming off. Not quite so much on the left side, and we'll look at the sagittals on this patient in just a minute. And then we go further inferiorly. This is that secondary cleft sign. So he's got like pubic plate problems, well, he's got bone problems, he's got pubic plate problems, he's got adductor longus problems and short adductor problems. Menu item number 17, I guess, on the whole palette of possibilities. No, I don't know, but. So then let's look at the sagittals. And this is where, so we're a little bit off midline, rectus, tendon, here's part of the symphysis, but see that's fluid at that adductor longus origin right there, that's partial avulsion of that adductor longus from the inferior part of the actual superior part of the pubic symphysis here on the right, okay? Look at the left side. So, well, here's the midline, okay, and so that's where this pubic plate's got some degeneration. And then here's the left side, abnormal signal at the origin of that adductor longus with the bone, but not quite as bad as on the opposite side. now, different patient. So on the prior one, let's go back for a second. So we would describe this as changes that, you know, could fit the syndrome of athletic pubalgia with describing the discrete partial tears of the rectus, the adductor longus on each side, the pubic plate changes, and the bony changes as well as that secondary cleft sign on the right, which is short adductor injury. This is a more acute example, and this is, again, a reason not you don't want to call this a sports hernia, because this is a radiologist, kind of a colleague of ours, who I think was doing ultimate frisbee and had an injury where he kind of had a groin strain. And you can see on the right side, this is, I can't quite tell if that's adductor longus right there or not, but that's where it should be coming off, whereas on the left, there's this heterogeneous low signal area surrounded by edema. And if we watch on the movie here, so look at the right side. Here's the longus coming off there on the right side and goes down. Whereas on the left side, I'll try to point with this pointer here, tendon surrounded by muscle, and as you come up towards the symphysis, it basically goes into this hematoma. So that is an adductor longus avulsion from the symphysis on the left side and surrounding edema, an acute strain type injury, right? Here you see some interfascial fluid and so forth on the left side. Our report said sports hernia, and that's just like a crazy thing to say about this because A, has nothing to do with a hernia, and we also want to stay away from that terminology in general. It'd be better to call this an acute, high-grade avulsion injury of the left adductor longus with associated hematoma formation. Turns out I saw him about 6 months after this for another injury that he incurred in a different event, and he was doing fine. This healed up without symptoms and conservative management. Now, just to finish up here, let me go back to the anatomy of the abdominal wall for a moment. So remember, this is one of the first things I was taught in anatomy, is like, let's go through the whole inguinal canal region and the different layers of external, internal, transversus, abdominis, and how they form about the rectus sheath, conjoint tendon, inguinal ligament. It does turn out that despite what I just talked about the rectus and the adductor and all that tendinous stuff, that there is an issue with this anatomy in here that can be relevant clinically. And I think that's where, in the US versus Britain, things are probably a little bit different in terms of emphasis, because there is this issue, what's called Gilmore's groin. Gilmore was British, 1980, and he coined this term sportsman's hernia. It's also known as sports hernia. And basically what he was talking about was this incipient hernia. By the way, it has nothing to do with Happy Gilmore, right? He was not an orthopedic surgeon, as far as I know. But here's an example where this mimic from this article showed, when they just opened up the inguinal region to look for a possible hernia, like this one's actually incising that fascia and starting to see some abdominal fat. But this one, they're just looking in the superficial ring here, and they're seeing bulging of tissues there. So there's an injury to the deep fascia in that inguinal, to the conjoint tendon region, and the bowel is sort of about to herniate through. So what they're showing is a dotted line. They're going to cut across this and then repair that defect. And so I've seen ultrasonographers look at this area, more experienced than I am, and look for bulging of this fat in a dynamic sense and be able to diagnose this so-called sports hernia based on this anatomy here. Again, not having really anything to do with the tendons, but they're right next door to each other, so you can see how it's all kind of confusing. Now, do I believe in that? I definitely do, because of a couple of cases, although I don't think it's very common. So if you look at this anatomy here, so here's the normal region of the conjoint tendon. It's really low down on the rectus. This might be a little bit higher, but you see like the inguinal canal here, spermatic cord, the deep fascia here, and so in the sagittal, this is an intact layer of deeper fascia here along that conjoint tendon. Whereas I had this case, and this was one of the was a quarterback who had fairly acute onset of groin pain at an inopportune time in his career, but nonetheless, here's a rectus abdominis, and if you look at the coronal images here, this right inguinal area just looks a little bit funny, right? This is the superficial inguinal ring region. The left is pretty normal, but this has kind of this ring-like thing going on. Maybe there's a little bit of edema there. And on the axial images, pretty subtle, but what we can see is like here's that fascia. It should be intact all the way across. There's a little defect right in here. And so what this is like a little direct inguinal hernia that's not containing bowel, but just containing fat, and that fat got a little bit inflamed and was painful. And this was surgically proved. So I know it from that case. I also know about it from this case here, which is another active running athlete with groin pain, basically originally worked up for a hip, labral injury, but found this small hernia here with a little defect in the deep fascia and fat herniating through it. So again, kind of a small direct inguinal hernia, which is, I think, basically what a sportsman's hernia in the Gilmore sense should be considered to be. So there's all the tendon things, and there's some of this that's actually kind of a real hernia, but it does get confusing. So here's the CT scan on that same 56-year-old where it's like fat bulging through. And I would say this is on my checklist of things now. So when I look at hip MRIs, go through all the different relevant anatomy, we also check the nerves for sure, and then we check for like regular hernias and for this type of abdominal wall pathology, because it can be relevant. I would also say in that context that if you look at hip MRIs and like how common are these rectus adductor aponeurotic problems and the pubalgia findings, I think it's fairly uncommon to have that seen as like incidental. The one young kid seemed to have it, but I think actually a lot of times if you have that pathology, it can well be symptomatic. I don't really know. But so to wrap it up here, this pubalgia is an important syndrome with complex anatomy. It's mostly these myotendinous structures about the symphysis. I would not use the term sports hernia. There is some interaction with the inguinal canal anatomy and injuries to that, so that misnomer is maybe not quite as difficult or as problematic as it seems. There's at least four injury areas to assess if you're reading these. Think about the bone, talk about the symphysis in the bone marrow and degenerative changes there. That rectus adductor pubic plate, kind of the part in front of the symphysis, but then specifically, are there partial tears, the adductor longus or short adductors? And if you do that, I think